Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, how would a British exit from the EU impact Arizona's economy? Also tonight, we'll see how green energy is being produced at a local wastewater treatment plant. And we'll look at Arizona's impact on developing the GI Bill, which turns 72 today. That's next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. A federal grand jury has indicted a state lawmaker for her involvement in an alleged food stamp scam. Democratic Representative Cecilia Velasquez is accused of three felonies, including fraud, unlawful use of food stamps, and theft by misrepresentation. The indictment was handed down last month and unsealed today. Velasquez, who represents areas of Litchfield Park, will be arraigned July 5th in Maricopa County Superior Court. The Arizona Coyotes could announce a move to Scottsdale by the end of the week. The hockey team is considering a site that was home to a drive-in theater for 30 years near Hayden and McKellips Roads, just north and west of the Loop 101 and 202 interchange. Coyotes Chief Executive Officer Anthony LeBlanc says that he would be surprised if the announcement is not made by the end of the week. The United Kingdom will vote tomorrow on whether or not to exit the European Union, a move that will have major repercussions around the world, including possibly here in the U.S. Joining us now is Jose Mendez, the Vice Chair of the Business Economics Department at ASU's W.P. Carey School of Business. Welcome to Arizona Horizon. Good to have you here.
Thanks for asking me.
You bet. The Britons, what exactly are they voting on tomorrow?
The British, are voting to leave the European Union. To become separate from the
The pros and the cons here. What are we seeing?
Well, on the part of the Leave group, the arguments are primarily they're non-economic. They're primarily arguments that they want to have greater sovereignty over control over their own decisions. They want to eliminate regulations. They're concerned that the European Union imposes too many regulations on them that they have no say in, and the third thing is that they want to control immigration. They don't want to participate in the Schengen policy that allows the free flow of movement of individuals within the European Union.
That's big, isn't it? The immigration policy.
Yes.
Could that be the biggest reason?
I think that's the biggest reason, but the British have always felt that because they're an island historically, they've always mm-hmm. felt that they're different from the continent, and so there's always that underlying tendency. But I think it is the immigration issue. They also think too that participating in the European Union is a cost to them, because on net they do make a payment to the European Union. They pay about $80 billion. Pounds, not dollars,
sure.
A year in contributions to the European Union.
And so the argument then to go ahead and stay in the EU is it's working, don't mess around with it?
It's working, don't mess around with it, and that leaving would have substantial costs. And in terms of the cost, a number of economists and as well as groups of economists have conducted a number of studies and developed a number of scenarios, and all of these economists are consistent, and it's surprising in their consistency in that there'll be two effects, at short-term, long-term. The big impact, the British will be poor as a result of leaving the European Union, and the estimates range from 1.3% of per capita income to as much as 9% of per capita income. So if you consider the midpoint, that represents about, on average per household, about $6,400 per year in perpetuity.
Interesting.
So economists are in agreement. There is one set of economists, though, that argue that leaving would allow them to be better off economically, in part because they would engage in free trade, and in part because they would not be making that contribution to the European Union.
Now, I want to get back to the UK in a second here, but the impact on the U.S. economy, what are you seeing out there?
I think for the United States, let me just say, all of the action and all of the impact is for the UK, not so much for the United States. For the United States, there may be some, while the U.S. is an important trading partner for the United Kingdom, they are not an important trading partner for us. So I think they account, if I'm correct, about 2.5% of our exports and imports, something around that, not a large number. So in terms of trade, it won't be an impact. There might be in the short term, in the immediate short term, the sort of the instability and the volatility created in financial markets. Mm-hmm. That will likely lead to a depreciation of the pound. Some estimates, projections go as much as 20%, and a strengthening of the dollar. And some people argue that, you know, the strengthening of the dollar, cause the United States to lose between 0.2 to 0.3% of economic growth. So that could occur in the short run. That could trigger a recession. There is also a second possibility, which is less likely, but the Finnish finance minister, the outgoing Finnish finance minister, said that there's so much uncertainty generated by the UK exit from the European Union that this could be the Lehman Brothers moment for Europe.
Oh, interesting.
And of course that would have implications for the United
exactly.
States.
What about Arizona? Are they much of a trading partner for Arizona?
Not really. So I think we would probably not, unless of course we go to this worst case scenario.
Yes, yes.
I think Arizona will feel nothing from
so
the
overall,
exit of the UK.
The UK would see less investment, probably see higher labor costs with the immigration policy. They would have no voice at all then in EU policy as well. It really makes you wonder why they're even thinking of doing this.
I think there's a lot of frustration and living standards, of course, have fallen after the 2008 recession. The British implemented austerity policies, then the European Union Central Bank made a policy error in terms of not engaging in quantitative easing in 2010, unlike what we did in the United States, and which contributed to the slowdown in growth in the European Union. And so I think there's the slowdown in the European Union, there's a slowdown in growth in Great Britain, and then there's also the impact of globalization. People are frustrated, they're uncertain, and so while the things that are causing their living standards to fall or not increase as rapidly, people are looking for answers, policy answers, and typically they look for simplistic answers.
Yeah.
They think, well, you know, we can correct all our problems. We can attribute it to immigration. We can attribute it to the participation in the European Union, which strangles stifles innovation. And they're looking for simplistic answers, and they think that this one bold step will correct all their problems. When in fact,
yeah, it could be just the opposite. We got to stop you right there. We'll find out what happens here in the coming days. Good information. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Get the inside scoop on what's happening at Arizona PBS. Become an insider. You'll receive weekly updates on the most anticipated upcoming programs and events. Get the insider delivered to your email inbox. Visit azpbs.org to sign up today.
Tonight's edition of Arizona Sustainability looks at turning waste into cash. The City of Phoenix Water Services Department will soon be selling biogas from its 91st Avenue Wastewater Treatment Plant. Here to tell us more is Catherine Sorensen, Phoenix Water Services Director, and Dennis Porter, the department's Assistant Director. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having us. What
is biogas?
Well, so a wastewater treatment plant does a couple of things. We reclaim water itself, the wastewater, to a really high standard for reuse. And that wastewater is then reused at the Palo Verde nuclear plant. It's also reused in local agriculture and for wetlands out of the Tres Rios facility. The biogas is actually a process related to the digestion of the solids at the plant. So just like your body treats both water or liquids and solids, a wastewater treatment plant basically does the same thing. When we treat the solids, a natural byproduct is methane gas. So what we can do is actually take that methane gas and clean it and then put it into a natural gas pipeline. We can sell that gas on the green energy market in California.
Interesting. Now, as far as the process for this, what's happening to all this waste right now? I mean, is it like being burned off in these little candles you see?
That's exactly what it's happening now. We have three large flares, and we just flare off that gas product as a waste byproduct into the atmosphere.
Wow, that's interesting. So, instead of doing that, I read as well boiler fuel as well.
Is it some boiler used for a little fuel, bit of fuel? But very little.
Very little. Mm-hmm. And now instead, you're going to sell it, huh?
That's correct.
Who are you going to sell it to?
Well, we're going to sell it to Ameresco, who's our third-party developer that's actually going to construct and operate the facility. It'll be up to them to be able to go out on the market and sell it.
And
we'll just sell them the gas directly.
Interesting. And how much does this, what kind of market we got here? What are we looking at?
Actually, apparently it's a really robust market, particularly in California, where there are some targets set for the use of renewable energy. So we're able to sell it and make a pretty decent profit off of this, which is a really great thing, not only for the city of Phoenix, but also a lot of people don't recognize the 91st Avenue Wastewater Treatment Plant is jointly owned by cities here in the valley, by the city of Phoenix, Mesa, Scottsdale, Tempe, and Glendale. So it's a good thing for the valley.
Is that why, I mean, 50% of the revenue will go to Phoenix, correct?
That's mm-hmm. correct.
And where does the other 50% go?
It's shared amongst those other
So those other municipalities will get that, huh?
They'll benefit as well.
And we have some shots here, I believe, of the plant. Tell us, run us through the process here, how this works. The water comes in, it's treated how? How does this work?
So the water, we're basically treating two streams. We're treating the liquid stream, and then we're treating the solid stream, what we call the biosolids, everything else that's in flushed down through your sinks into your toilets. So we treat both of those. So what with respect to the biogas, we're treating the biosolids. Right now what we do with those solids is we treat them in the anaerobic digesters, we dry them a little bit more, and they're able to be taken out and used as fertilizer for non-food crops. And so that's what happens. That byproduct methane is actually generated in the anaerobic digestion process, which right now is just burned off.
Right.
So what we'll be able to do now is take that, scrub it, clean it, and reuse it.
And transfer it by way of I think we have a shot of the pipeline mm-hmm. as well. Is this a new pipeline? Is it something that's been built for this purpose? Something already there?
It's something that will be built for this purpose. There's actually an old pipeline there because apparently the city of Phoenix did this many decades ago, but didn't find it lucrative enough because back then there was not really a market for renewable energy. It's really that market that makes this so profitable and so worth doing.
And again, this is at 91st. We've done a number of stories on this trade planet here, Tres Rios, the Wetlands
yeah.
Project, and now this. I mean, a lot of stuff out there is being recycled, isn't it?
It's really cool. And in fact, for the first time ever, what we're going to be able to say is that everything that comes out of that plant is beneficially reused. So it's part of the circular economy ideas. It's really great. We're going to be reclaiming the water using. And what's interesting about that is that a lot of people don't understand that the city of Phoenix and its partner cities has been, we've been reclaiming this wastewater for 40 years. A lot of communities across the West are only just now realizing how valuable this resource is. So we've really been leaders in this. But we'll be reusing the wastewater itself, the reclaimed water, the biosolids for local agriculture, and now the biogas in the California green energy market.
And the goal is 15% renewable energy citywide, correct?
That's correct. And we'll be meeting that goal earlier than we had hoped.
What was it? The original goal was 2020-something?
2025, I believe.
And now the goal is what?
We think we'll be there by 2018.
My goodness. And this will go on, is this online already?
It'll be online spring of 2018.
Spring of 2018. All right. Well, good luck with this. Congratulations. Sounds like a great deal.
Yeah.
Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Our continuing look at veterans issues through our Arizona Veterans Coming Home series focuses tonight on the GI Bill, which turns 72 today, and is considered by many to be one of the most successful pieces of social legislation ever written. We welcome Jack August, historian and administrator at the Arizona Capitol Museum, to talk about the GI Bill and Arizona's place in the program's history. Good to see you again.
Nice
Thanks
to see
for
you.
Being here.
Right.
What is the GI Bill?
Well, it's the act that returning veterans from World War II had some options, some opportunities to go to school, to borrow low interest loans, to buy houses and start businesses, in essence.
It's officially called the Servicemen's Readjustment Act of 1944, kind of like a New Deal for veterans, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, and that's a good point. And some of the those that opposed the bill, Robert Taft, for example, Senator Robert Taft of Ohio, and Congressman Everett Dirksen thought it was an extension of the New Deal, and they were tired of it. They had New Deal fatigue, and so there was opposition, but fortunately for our veterans, Ernest McFarland did the heavy lifting, Senator Ernest McFarland, and he was a freshman senator, and he acted like he wasn't a freshman senator and just really went to every subcommittee hearing, executive committee hearing. He was the voice on the radio, not the face quite yet. Television wasn't there, but he was involved in television later. And so he did a lot of lifting, and he drafted the most important provisions that I think are the legacy of the bill, and they still impact us today.
Senator Ernest McFarland from Arizona?
Yes.
That's a big deal. He really was a factor there, wasn't he?
Yes, he was the big factor. And he really started thinking about it in 1942, started talking about it to the to a lot of veterans groups, and kind of really had it outlined in 42. 43, it was still pushing back and forth like any piece of big legislation. And finally, they get it through, and they get the House and the Senate to agree.
Let's talk about the impetus behind here. What exactly was the reason that this was considered an important thing to do? I mean, we look now and we think helping veterans returning from something like World War II, that should be kind of a no-brainer. I guess what happened to veterans from World War I played a big part, didn't it?
That's correct. And Senator McFarland was a veteran of World War I, though he didn't go overseas. In fact, he was very ill, but the military doctors virtually saved his life. And he thought it was, as he started his local career in county politics and as a judge and a lawyer, he witnessed in 1932 the bonus marchers, World War I veterans that were being crippled by the Depression. They had no chance, and in fact, they ended up in Anacostia Flats in D.C. camping out in their Hooverville, as they called it. And none other than Dwight Eisenhower was the on the ground guy that kind of split them up, and General MacArthur as well.
Yeah, I think MacArthur and Eisenhower actually were at odds there, because Eisenhower wasn't too happy about MacArthur going down there to break this thing up.
No.
I think he called him a couple of salty names there.
Yes, he did.
So this was worked on, and this was passed really before the end of the war.
Yes, it was, and that's, I think that was visionary on Senator McFarland's part, as well as those in the veterans groups. And there was even a mother of the bill, Elizabeth Rogers, Massachusetts Republican. So there was a bipartisan dimension to the bill, and she worked it in the House. And McFarland really did the big lifting in the Senate. But he had some help, of course.
And so what was the impact of the GI Bill?
Oh, my gosh. A generation that John Kenneth Galbraith calls the Great Society. It was a generation that we had affluence instead of a depression after a war. It was just a profound influence. It created the great middle class that we have today. Housing, 20 million veterans got education. And the impact there was their dependents. It may have impacted 50 million up to this point in time. And since that time, there have been revisions in 1952 with Korea, and then 1966 and onward, even up to the 9/11 bill into 2000s. We've adapted and refined the bill in order to make sure that our veterans are treated as they should be.
What were some of those adaptions? I mean, or adaptations?
Adaptations. Well, yeah, they expanded. McFarland was always for expanding it, by the way. And so hospitalization, for example, that wasn't really part of the first iteration of the bill. An increase in the amount of funds for education, for going to school and all that. It had to change as the economy changed. So did the payouts for loans and all that.
Sure. So, but originally it was tuition assistance, home and business loans for the most part.
For the most part, right.
And some folks think this is the most successful piece of social legislation this country has seen.
I think there's a consensus among historians it's the greatest piece of social legislation in the history of this country.
And again, who was against this?
Just a few, they might be early day Tea Partier types that didn't want the government intervening in any way in the economy, like Robert Taft. But later on, he comes on board in the 52 Act. He finally sees the good, so people can change their minds about these types of things.
With that in mind, what is the future of the GI Bill?
I think it's going to be part of the social and cultural fabric of veterans affairs from now until you and I are long gone.
I think
it's really part, and you know, we continue. It's a high profile news item all the time, and so we see our problems with the veterans affairs issues in Phoenix, for example. I think as long as people like you do your job and keep a lens on it, it'll be good for all of us.
And as far as the variations and the adaptations and these sorts of things, the ways of military change. So how you help those who serve in the military, it's got to change as well.
Oh, it has to. Absolutely. Women, minorities, all of those people, it changed from the original one. We had to cross a couple of racial barriers after 1944. Certainly, I think it can still be improved upon, but we've made great progress since that time.
As a historian, last question before you go. As a historian, what's the one thing people don't realize about the GI Bill?
That it expanded our urban-suburban civilization. People were able, instead of living in apartments after the war, they were able to get a loan and move out and buy a house. And that really changed the shape of our cities and how we live.
Welcome to suburbia, huh?
Yes.
All right. Good to see you again. Thanks for being here.
Thanks a lot.
And Thursday on Arizona Horizon, we'll tell you about a new way of measuring the state's progress in helping job creation. And we'll learn about research designed to make solar panels cheaper and more accessible. That's at 5:30 and 10 on the next Arizona Horizon. If you'd like to watch tonight's program again or see any previous edition of Horizon, maybe see what we have in store for the future, check us out on the web, azpbs.org/horizon. That's azpbs.org. /horizon. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
The Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability is the heart of sustainability at ASU, advancing research, education, and business practices for an urbanizing world. You can learn more at sustainability.asu.edu/TV.